My top tip, or actually there'd be two top tips for publishing for somebody that's really early in their career. One would be make sure that you know all the background of your, you know, what you're writing about, so that you make sure you reference all the previous work that's been done, and that you put it in the context of what's been done. And sometimes you have to go back beyond 2005. I know a lot of the younger people don't always go back, you know, past 2005 on the lit search, because they think, well, that's far enough. But really, there's a lot of good chemistry that was actually done in the 1800s, 1900s that's relevant. And then the other thing would be choice of reviewers. When you submit an article, make sure that you put down some referees that you would recommend that could do a good review of your article. But make sure that those people are experts in the field, and not necessarily, you know, somebody that you had a beer with at a meeting or a friend or something like that. Make sure it's somebody that can really do a good review, because that will ultimately help your paper in the end, because you'll get good feedback, which will improve your paper, and then it'll, you know, it'll be a better paper in the journal.
People get tempted to copy and follow the footsteps of people who have gone through before. But I like to suggest that the best way to stand out as a scientist is to focus on new things and novelty of your research. So try to focus on why your work is different from others.
Think carefully about what the impact is of your discovery or invention or the advance you have made. So make absolutely clear, even if it's a very tiny advance, make clear, you know, why this is important and why the community should read this and why it should be published in the Royal Society Journal of High Standards.
I think it's really important for authors to tell a story in their paper. So they don't just need to report a particular piece of data or a particular method, but actually to have a narrative with a beginning, middle and end. It sounds obvious, but they need to set up the problem that they're trying to address. Authors need to, and then explain the work that they've done, the experiments that they've done, but also then conclude in how that addresses the fundamental problem they've set up. So in a sense that there needs to be this is what we thought was the problem, this is how we addressed it, and this is what it means. And that meaning is often very much lost with people get too close to the data. But it's the meaning that people will take away from the paper and the meaning that they'll cite.
You know, to write a good paper, you should put a context there very clearly so people can follow, you know, the flow of your story. And of course, you know, the structure, the data organization, all these things are very important.
I mean, my top tip would be obviously to just write the best paper you can, that goes without saying, and to make sure that you've worked very hard with your co-authors to get it as good as it can be. But particularly focus on the abstract. Sometimes they get a bit forgotten and they can be written the last thing in the paper and put together in a bit of a rush. It's always worth remembering it's probably the bit that people will really read from your paper. It's the bit that they'll find in the online database. It's got to cover the key points and also draw them in, make them want to go and look at the article, see how you've done things and read the underlying science. So a good abstract can really go a long way, I think, in publishing good articles.
My top tip for publishing is to ensure that the title and the abstract of the article contains keywords that explain and describe what's within the article. This is especially important when it comes to search engines, since they're going to pick up these terms and they're going to build up an index of those terms, so they're going to, you know, deliver that content based on what's within that title.
If I was to advise a new author, I would suggest that they try to write a concise cover letter. I find that really helps me work out that I've chosen the correct journal. And also, I find often that in phrasing the cover letter of why it's important, I often end up going back to my own manuscript and rewriting the introduction.
Write a good cover letter highlighting the novelty of your work. That is something really important, and many times, as an associate editor, I do not see it. That is something definitely all the editors across the board, across the journal, in different publishing houses wants to see. They would like to see a cover letter, crisp, bullet pointed, what exactly is the novelty of someone's work.
When you think about submitting a paper, I think it's critically important to think about that paper in the context of what the reader will want to read. And if you think that as a reader, You'd be really happy with that paper in a given journal, then go ahead and submit it. If you scratch your head and say, I don't know, but I'll try anyway, odds are you may not be putting the paper in the right journal.
I always tell my students to wait another day, another week, and come back again to proofread it. You will find many mistakes or typos. So this is very important for the quality of the manuscript.
So we're often asked by authors how important formatting is when they submit their paper to us, because each publisher has their own house style. So my top tip is actually that it's not that important to do that on your first submission. If your paper's accepted, then we'll make sure it's formatted to RSC requirements, as long as in your submission your paper is clear and understandable for the referees and the editors. That's the most important thing.
Do not let the rejections, you know, dishearten you, depress you. It happens to everybody. It happened to everybody. Yes, everybody feels bad when a paper gets rejected, wherever it, you know, whichever the journal it is. But do not take it personally. Do not take it very seriously, though. Learn from it, but do not take it personally, and definitely do not let that frustrate you not doing good work. So, you know, continuously evolve, learn from the mistakes, and make yourself better.
My advice is, as one of the best organizations on this chemical science, I think Royal Society of Chemistry has one of the best journals in every branch of chemistry. So I will strongly encourage them to submit their best work to Royal Society of Chemistry.